A new poll from Gallup shows President Biden's ratings have sunk below those of Vice President Kamala Harris, with 43% of respondents approving of Biden's performance compared to Harris' 44%. Over half of all respondents disapproved of both POTUS and the VP. Here to weigh in is Brianna Joy Gray. She's the host of the Bad Faith podcast and former national press secretary for the Sanders campaign. Welcome, Brianna.
Thank you, Ryan.
Now, obviously, this is all within the margin of error, but, you know, consistently for the first, year or so of the Biden administration, she was outside the margin of error and below Biden's approval rating. What do you make of the fact that she's ticking up while he's ticking down?
I don't know. Maybe people's attentions are divided. Look, the reality is that the dislike of Kamala Harris, her lack of popularity, was largely not super substantive, right? It's kind of the fact that she was given no real role in the campaign, that she wasn't up to much, that the tasks that she was tasked with, that she performed rather unwell. There was that famous do not come moment, her gif-able moment at the border waving beatifically like a beauty queen into the immigration center, all of these kinds of moments that added up not to much, but all in all are hardly, lying about weapons of mass destruction or any of the many things other vice presidents have done in the past. Now it looks like people are focusing their attention on Joe Biden, rightly so, because of the failure of Build Back Better, which falls squarely on his lap. Of course, there have been pushes for the vice president to, weigh in on the filibuster reform. She personally has been very vocal about her frustration around voting rights. It does feel like there's potentially some push and pull there, especially when you look at the media coverage of the displeasure of her own people in the White House, which seems to be coming from inside the House, as it were. However, now if you're going to try to come to some logical determination as to why these polls have slipped the way they have, and Biden is now edging her out as the least favorable of the two, I think it's largely due to the fact that we are now focusing on Biden's agenda and Biden's failure to pass it.
Yeah, Biden's great political advantage has been that when he's not front and center, when he's off camera, he's kind of popular. Ended up being a huge asset during a campaign that was not normal, where you couldn't actually do that much campaigning, where he was like stuck in a basement, hiding out so that he doesn't get COVID, and he won. He won because when he's not actively involved, people seem to like him. But then the more he's in the news, the more he's talking. I think that I agree with you. There's a lot to kind of knock him for. Kind of the idea that the pandemic is luckily, deaths are not in a bad shape, but cases are just totally out of control. The government has no handle on it whatsoever. So I agree that it's a Biden shifting, not really a Harris shifting. But, what do you think? We talk about this on the show a lot. Harris will be the kind of de facto successor to Biden unless there's, some dramatic shakeup or something. What could she do to improve her poll numbers so that, she doesn't want to be below Biden, but even if she's just at his level right now, that's probably not an encouraging sign either.
It's difficult because Kamala Harris was never popular, and mm-hmm. I cannot state this enough. Ryan, I evoke this article all the time. You wrote it over at The Intercept. At a certain point in the campaign, Bernie Sanders was outpacing Kamala Harris 2-1 with black voters. The idea in a recent New York Times article that she was added to the ticket to, gin up enthusiasm among black voters, if that was the real thinking, then it was a fool's errand because black voters have never shown any real interest in Kamala Harris. She very famously had to drop out of the Democratic primary before her own state voted because she was polling below Andrew Yang in California, and on and on and on, right? She just has never been popular with the constituencies that people claim she was popular with, or constituencies beyond that.
Right. So the assumption is even a bit like Michael Scott benign racist too, right?
Right.
Yeah, she is. I was thinking about this morning on whether or not I was going to say it, but it does seem like she's suffering a little bit from the soft bigotry of low expectations, which isn't to say that she couldn't be a better candidate. I think a lot of people, when she won in 2017, when her Senate race, really expected her to be the heir apparent, if only because of these superficial identity-focused reasons. I mean, there was article after article about how she was going to be the next Barack Obama. The thing is, Barack Obama was a good politician who was misleading, and dishonest about the kind of president he was going to be, but was ultimately charming and much better at this game than Kamala Harris has ever demonstrated that she's going to be. Yeah. One bit of advice I might offer is to stop relying on the same counsel and guidance that Hillary Clinton relied on, including Hillary Clinton herself, which that recent New York Times piece pointed out. She has reached out to other women politicians for advice and has been apparently leaning on Hillary Clinton for guidance in this moment, which doesn't seem to me to be particularly well advised.
Yeah, that's exactly what we were going to discuss next. The New York Times, for for viewers to be aware of, has reported that Harris has turned to Hillary Clinton for advice on how to deal with her unpopularity. According to the Times, quote, "Faced with declining approval ratings, a series of staff departures, and a drumbeat of criticism from Republicans and the conservative news media, she has turned to powerful confidants, including Hillary Clinton, to help plot a path forward. Let's take advice from the one person who was capable of losing to Donald Trump. What could go wrong?"
Yeah, it's confusing. It's not just Hillary. Also, remember, isn't it the case that her sister Maya Harris, who is also an advisor to Kamala Harris, was an advisor to Hillary Clinton? It does feel like the whole team has just shifted over to Kamala Harris. And you can say what you want to say about there being a discriminatory element, a biased element, as there always is in some capacity when you're dealing with these kind of first types. I wouldn't deny that sexism played a role in Hillary Clinton's loss. But I also very much believe that a woman who wasn't Hillary Clinton could have won, and that a vice president who isn't Kamala Harris, but who is Black, Asian, and female in some combination, could obviously be doing a much better job if she behaved differently. I also do want to say that Kamala Harris at this point is shackled to the Biden agenda. And whereas she advocated for certain aspects of a progressive policy regime earlier in her career, was one of the first signatories for Medicare, to Bernie Sanders' Medicare for All bill, supported recurring $2,000 checks, monthly recurring $2,000 checks, tweeted that not only should vaccines be free, but that treatment for vaccines should be free. All of these beliefs would bolster her popularity if she could return to them again. However, she is being hamstrung by tethering herself to a man who, during the primary, she described as a supporter of a racist busing policy, a eulogizer of Strom Thurmond, and someone who has been on the wrong side of history throughout his basically entire political career. And that's something that I think that no political advisor can help her wiggle out of.
Yeah, but she laughed about that afterwards. So, no big deal, right? That was just politics.
It was a debate.
didn't work.
No.
Well, Brianna, thank you so much for joining us.
It's my pleasure. Happy holidays.
Happy holidays to you. And we will have more Rising right after this.